would just ask that you also attach your minds back, excuse me, to 2017, and you'll remember that it was more than 100 days since the start of the fiscal year. We still were out without a budget. At Connecticut Voices for Children, we had already done 19 analyses, so we had analyzed 19 different budget proposals in varying levels of detail. There were a lot of closed-door negotiations between leadership of the two parties, and as a result, the budget bill came out with the implementer that passed with supermajority. And frankly, there wasn't really enough time for everyone, certainly not all the legislators and certainly not all the advocates, to fully understand all the details that went into it. And once it was passed and we looked at it, what became clear is that there really were some big downside consequences to the upside, which was that all of a sudden we were seeing bipartisanship in the state. You know, until that implementer, until the budget bill came down, Connecticut really was marked by such incredible gridlock. I've lost my glasses again. Connecticut was really marked by gridlock and the ability to move things forward, and there was a great deal of excitement that not only have we moved past gridlock, but we've gotten to supermajorities. The problem was that the supermajorities included these four new fiscal restraints, and because the fiscal restraints, including new definitions for the spending cap, were passed by supermajorities, it meant the new definitions for the spending cap met the constitutional threshold and became part of the constitutional spending cap. So not only do we have three fiscal restraints that are of real concern, but we have a constitutional fiscal restraint which imposes a pretty high threshold to change it. So, why does it matter, and who should care about it? Again, there were rushed to the floor. There was not the kind of scrutiny that one might desire. The reality is that the restrictions, the way that they're framed, could indeed exacerbate, and we believe will exacerbate, the budget crisis. And perhaps of most concern in terms of understanding the misfit between these restrictions and the needs of the state is that the restrictions don't address the root causes of the fiscal crisis that we're facing. So while there was excitement about moving forward a budget that supposedly had structural reforms in it, we were making real changes to the budget setting process, and structural reform sounds good, it's always what Connecticut Voices is advocating for, these structural reforms, because they didn't address the root crisis, actually don't take us in the right direction. So even though we're not going to talk about how we got to where we are in great depth, it is worth doing just a little bit of a side tour to say, well, what are those root causes after all? And it's one thing to say they don't face the root causes, but what were they? And just in a nutshell, and I know that a lot of you have heard our presentations about how do we get to where we are, we're really talking about the convergence of three different things. One is the slow economic growth that we have recovered from the 2008 recession at a much slower rate than recovered from prior recessions, at a much slower rate than other states in New England and across the country have recovered. And as a result, with a slower recovery, there's less revenue coming into the state, so we have slower revenue growth. At the same time, we have the 70 to 80 year in the making pension crisis, where apart from any question about whether these pensions are at the appropriate rate, if they give appropriate levels of benefits, the reality is that all those questions aside, the failure to pay down in a timely way the annual contributions to those pension funds means that the liability right now is outsized and threatens to really dwarf just about everything else in the budget. And so a multi-decade, over half a decade's worth of failure to attend to those then current payments has put us in a real structural crisis. And then the third thing, which is related to the first, is that there has not been the kind of change to the revenue system that would modernize it and allow us to capture new changes in behavior, new ways of doing business. So that, for example, our sales tax is still largely based on goods as opposed to services. Our sales tax actually does cover more services than a lot of others, but still not enough. And because it doesn't equally cover goods and services, It means that changes in behavior, we're now moving to a much more service-based economy, much more of economic transaction is going without taxes. So too, with respect to the move of a lot of transactions to internet-based sales, because we haven't done enough to close at internet-based sales loopholes, there again is a fair amount of revenue that we're not capturing. So slowing growth in the economy, failure to modernize our tax system, getting less revenue, a huge spike in expenses because of past failures coming home to roost, and you've got the long-term structural deficit. That's a very different origin story than the origin story that might drive, for example, the fiscal restraints, where they're really all about we're spending too much and we need to rein in spending, period, end of story, and these restraints are really going to help us do that. So let's talk about the restraints, the budget restrictions. There are four of them. The first one is the spending cap, and it's the one most of you all are familiar with. You know that it was first created in 1991, and it was part of the so-called grand bargain, that there was a desire to pass an income tax. If we were to institute an income tax, people wanted to ensure that there were protections against runaway revenue growth and runaway spending. And so there was an agreement that we should put a cap on spending, that it would only increase a certain amount year over year, regardless of whether or not we brought in even more revenue than what we might be able to spend. And that was supposed to be a cap on growth with the income tax. As you know, there were terms in the spending cap that had to be defined by statute. The term is what is covered, what is the general budget expenditure that's limited, and how do we limit it, by what rate of increase. Those terms were defined in statutes that were in place before the passage of the constitutional amendment. There was a lot of back and forth as to when and how they were applicable, but basically the last 2 years they really haven't been enforced, and so there was a need to define them. There were bills in the legislature that sought to define those terms, and they consistently did not pass because there was a real partisan breakdown over how much should be covered and how much should the budget be allowed to grow over time. And so the terms that were really disputed were general expenditures and the increased rate of growth. In the bill that did pass, it included a definition for the spending cap that put new things underneath the cap that heretofore had not been under. The biggest one was the pensions. And the pensions now will go under the spending cap, partially in 2023. That'll be when all of the state worker pensions go under, and fully in 2026, when the teacher pensions also go under. The problem is that these pensions are going to actually reach their highest levels after they go under the spending cap. They will continue to grow after they go to the spending cap. That means that there will be more growth in the non-functional expenses and continued crowding out of other expenses.
Just one minute. When you say pensions are under, is it the money that has to go in to fund them, or is it the money that has to go out to pay?
Excellent question. It is the money that needs to go in to fund them. So because that money, because the level of spending each year to continue to fund the pension will continue to grow after they come under the cap, that means that we know that there's going to be increased crowd out of other things. Moreover, and we believe that this was a technical mistake, we don't believe it was intentional, but it's part of the reason why rushing things and doing them behind closed doors can be a mistake. There was language with respect to the pensions, well, with respect to new expenditures that come under the cap, that said when something new is included in the general budget expenditure, newly put under the cap, newly appropriated, you have to rebase the cap. So if you could spend $100 in year one and you had a 10% growth rate, so you could spend $110 in year two, if in year two a new $100 of money that otherwise had not been under the cap came under it, you'd rebase it so now you had $200 and you could grow, I guess, 20% based on that. The problem is, while that was intended to ensure that when the pensions come under, we'll have to rebase, so it's not as if you put $2 billion in pension payments under the cap, all of a sudden you have to find or crowd out $2 billion. When the pensions, because the pensions are already appropriated, when they come under the cap, they will not be newly appropriated. They will just be newly counted against the cap. That means by a strict reading of the statute, there will not be a requirement that there be a rebasing. And so while legislators may well say, oh, we'll fix that, that wasn't intentional, you have to have a supermajority to fix it. And we haven't been able to get a supermajority for the most part, except in this one strange circumstance of a behind closed door deal. So we can't say that we know we're going to fix it. And that should scare everyone, because that is a huge, unintended, but huge problem. The other thing is that other terms that were used or that were defined, in addition to pensions, we used to exempt grants to distressed municipalities from the spending cap. And the idea, the reasoning behind that was obvious. If you want to ensure that we meet the needs of children, families, communities in our least enriched, most impoverished areas, we want to make sure that we can direct funds to them, and we won't be able to increase those funds and meet identified need if there's a hard ceiling of the spending cap. And so until this past year, grants to distressed municipalities were always excluded. Now they come under the cap. So all of a sudden, if you want to directly address the issue of under-resourcing of our schools, if you want to address infrastructure in the cities, if you want to make investments, for example, to address newly identified problems or building problems, all of that is going to get counted against other spending in a way that it would not have before. And then the other thing is that the general expenditure baseline, in addition to saying what's under the cap, it defines how much can grow year over year. Problem with the way it defined that is we're starting from a low base. In other words, we've had a number of years of austerity budgeting. So if we start with a strict limitation or a smaller rate of increase year over year than we've had in the past, and if we're doing that based on a base that, wait a second, I wasn't supposed to be doing this part of the presentation. Oh my gosh, I'm going to finish spending cap and hand it over. I am just, I'm a microphone hog. How embarrassing. So we have this growth that is starting on already low base. And so that in and of itself is a problem. Then the growth is going to be based on 5-year average of inflation, or the 5-year average of growth in the CPI. 5 years is just enough time to make sure that we're still getting dragged back into the slow growth of immediately after the recession. If we had either a shorter or a longer period of time, it would incorporate not only the slow years, but also higher growth years before the recession. By only using a 5-year average, it means that the rate of growth is depressed. And then finally, by way of further depression, they defined it so that it's based on actual expenditures in a prior year, not authorized expenditures. That means that if there are lapses, then lower than expected revenues, there have to be holdbacks to address lower than expected revenues. Those holdbacks, those lapses, will lower the base for further years as well. So that's problematic. And now I'm going to stop the media hub.
Hi all, thanks Ellen for that great introduction. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the second cap that we're worried about that's going to be covered by the bond law, which I promise you we're going to get to. And that's the volatility cap, which you guys all may have heard about in the news. So the motivation for the volatility cap sort of comes from really last night, where if you guys might remember, the legislature had this big plan to pass a budget. And late April, early May comes around, they find out, oh my gosh, we're actually getting a lot less revenue than expected, and we're getting burned by that. And the reason we had a lot less revenue than we expected was that a portion of our income tax did not come in as much as expected. And it wasn't just any part of our income tax, it was actually a very specific portion, which you see behind you, estimates and finals. And that's the portion that's the most equitable. It comes mostly from corporations and stocks, so generally wealthy people, but it's also very volatile, so it was up and down, it's hard to predict. So the legislature came together and said, all right, we want to try to mitigate this volatility so in the future we don't have to deal with these prediction issues and we don't get burned when we're trying to build a budget. And so they came up with the volatility cap. Good idea in theory. Lots of other states have volatility caps. In fact, Connecticut had a volatility cap that was going to go into effect in 2021, but this got hurt a bit, as Alan's going to go over right now. So this new volatility cap What it basically says is if we ever get more estimates and finals revenue, this income tax revenue that comes from stocks, corporations, and so on, above $3.15 billion, which is about fiscal year 18 predicted levels at that time, then it has to go to the rainy day fund. And you can't really touch the rainy day fund very easily. There's some real restrictions. So it's essentially, for a lot of reasons, just restricted. And it just says $3.15 billion. It doesn't say if your economy grows, then you can increase it. It doesn't say if you decide to change income tax rates, then that's okay. It's just $3.15 billion. It's just one number. And the problem with this is that as our economy grows, we're going to be growing revenue, just not because it's volatile, because our economy is growing. And that money, not because it's volatile, is just going to go straight into the rainy day fund. And as I alluded to earlier, actually, the comptroller, along with other legislators, in a bipartisan manner, in 2015 or 2016, actually passed a volatility cut that was much more aligned with best practices. They worked with a few research centers and others. It was actually tied to volatility. It wasn't just a number. It would have mitigated a lot of these issues. So unfortunately, there is sort of a missed opportunity here. And so the third cap, or the third restriction, is the bond cap. So Connecticut issued bonds to borrow money for all sorts of projects, transportation, school construction, and so on every year. There are lots of different components to the bond cap. One of them, just to highlight, is the issuance cap. That is, Connecticut can only issue $1.9 billion or borrow $1.9 billion, essentially, each year. When you compare that to sort of a historical levels, you see it's actually much lower than 2017, 2016, or 2014 levels. And that's going to mean, you know, it's going to be much less flexible to borrow money in cases of emergencies, in cases of construction, and so on. So you might say, okay, Ray and Helen, you know, these all seem kind of terrible, but you know, we can fix them, right? Like we can, you know, maybe we'll get a supermajority one day, or maybe we'll just get a majority for the volatility cap or for the bond cap. And the problem is now the bond lock, which is what we're going to talk about now. And the problem is that the bond lock essentially is going to cement these three previous flawed restrictions into place without an ability to change them for the next 10 years, starting this May, if we do not stop it this May. To be more specific, what the bond lock actually says is, it was part of last year's implementer, and it basically says, whenever Connecticut issues a bond, beginning this May, May 15, 2018, it has to promise as part of that bond not to change the spending cap, volatility, or the bond cap. It has to essentially freeze them in time as they are now with all of their flaws. And we pretty much, we have to promise not to change them. And bonds are contracts. Right? They're legal contracts, and the state has a legal obligation to continue to follow those contracts into the future. And that also means we're going to cement those weaknesses in the future for the next 10 years. And look, you know, you might say, okay, so what happens if Connecticut does try to break? And, you know, it's really risky. We're not totally sure what's going to happen. It would definitely invite litigation. Connecticut might have to pay penalties. Might have to pay off the bonds early. Sometimes you're allowed to pay off the bonds, sometimes you're not. But really, it's essentially going to make it extremely difficult to fix or help improve any of these restrictions over the next decade.
Can you tell us about bond trolls?
Of course. Wow. You might be wondering why I make a picture of an ugly thing. And so someone might say, okay, great. So, you know, like, okay, so maybe we'll get sued. But who's really going to sue for this? Like, if you break this, who's really going to sue for this? And what we found is that there are people who actually very purposely look for covenants like this, with, you know, really restrictive covenants, and buy the bond for the sole purpose of suing the state, right? And they're called bond trolls. So they're under the bridge, they're looking for our bond covenants, and they're ready to enter court. So there are people out there who would probably do this, and it's very scary.
So it's not just an academic concern that, you know, I actually thought it was pretty academic at first, but the existence of these bond trolls means that there is a stronger likelihood that these weaknesses in the language would be exploited if we ignored them. And if they were exploited, that would really be met.
So, okay, so we're locking these things into place. How exactly is it going to impact children and families? So, in large part, because of these flaws that I mentioned earlier, if you look at this sort of historical perspective on spending for children and families, I'm sure a lot of you are familiar with our children's budget. You can see here that non-functional costs have taken up a larger part of the budget. spending for children and families sitting in the smaller part of the budget. And this would really probably just get exacerbated under these proposals. For instance, with the spending cap, bringing pensions under the cap, if we don't amortize or spread out the cost for the teacher pensions, or if our rate of return assumptions aren't right for those pensions, you know, we're looking at billions of dollars of increased spending for those pensions that we're pretty much going to have to replace with cuts to other services such as those for children and families because of the spending cap.
I just want to emphasize that. This means that if the bond block stays in there after May 15th, and that means that the spending cap definitions cannot be changed, that means that the growth, for example, the teacher pensions, which could be a growth of about $5 billion, could, in all likelihood, would have to be made up for by cuts elsewhere. And you can't make cuts in federally mandated programs. You can't make cuts in contractual obligations like debt. You have to make the cuts in those programs of choice, which are investments in our children and our families and our communities.
So you might be wondering, okay, like this seems like a pretty strong restriction on the state. Like, is this legal? Like, can states actually enter into contracts that are that strong? And we've been working with students and Professor Theo also, and it's pretty questionable, and it's something we're still pursuing. For instance, that quote up there, surrender an essential attribute of its sovereignty, that comes from a Supreme Court decision. But even just the potential litigation of having to go through all this, you know, of showing bondholders that, hey, we're willing to try to get around this could be extremely damaging for our borrowing costs into the future. So it's something we're worried about.
What's this doing to the state's bond rating?
That's a great question. We've been trying to get into contact with bond counsel or rating agencies to figure that out. We haven't been able to. If anyone in this room could connect us, we would love that.
There was a recent piece that was written by the Urban Institute, actually by the Tax Foundation, which is a project of the Urban Institute, the Brookings Institute, by an expert in bond obligations. And she mentioned that, based on her research, these covenants often can lead toward lower bond ratings and higher interest rates. But that's based on what she's seen happen in other areas. It still would be great to get bond counsel to say, whoa, this is really going to be bad. That's not something we've been able to get as yet, and welcome your help with.
Absolutely. So it is important to talk about the escape clause a little bit, because there are some people that say, oh, there are escape clauses, it's fine. And, you know, it's probably not. So there are three essential ways that the bond block can be gotten around, sort of by law. There's one which says, if you provide adequate provision for the bondholders, then you can circumvent this. But it doesn't define what adequate provision means. And it's sort of unclear, it's pretty legally ambiguous as to what does adequate provision mean. And so, you know, the state could engage in that costly and risky litigation. But again, it's a risk, bondholders might not like it. It's a whole can of worms that they're opening.
And the best example of that is, think what's going on with the teacher's pension, right? That also has an adequate provision language in it. The governor's now arguing that because of that adequate provision language, he can find out ways to restructure the teacher pension deal. There are many other people who say, actually, no, it prevents you from doing that. And indeed, there's been dispute about that over the last 3 to 4 years. So we know, in fact, that the adequate provision language is sufficiently ambiguous that it does prevent, has been shown to prevent, any sort of affirmative action or change at the state level.
Absolutely. So the second way you can sort of quote-unquote get around it is through this emergency provision, which says, if you have a 3/5 majority in each chamber of the legislature, and if the governor declares an emergency, then you can get out of the bond block for 1 year. And it has to be in the year going on right now. So there's two problems with that. The first, that we saw how long it took to get a 3/5 majority with the spending cap. Now, might not be that easy in the future as well. The second is that it's only for the year in progress. So if there's a multi-year crisis, let's say there's another hurricane or there's a huge storm or anything like that that might require multiple years of investment.
Or the pensions aren't rebased.
Exactly. The legislature will need a supermajority, a 3/5 majority every single year they want to bypass the cap and do that. So, not great. The third way is refinancing the bonds. Now, sometimes the state issues what they call refunding bonds to refinance its debt. And the specific language is that you can do that and it won't be subject to the bond block. The problem is that issuing bonds itself is going to run up against the bond cap. So you're actually going to have a separate declaration just to get past the bond cap before you can even do that for the bond lock. The second issue with this is that not all bonds are very easily refunded. You know, some, for instance, might not have a refunding provision. If they don't have that, then we might have to pay a penalty, we might have to pay it off completely, you know, we might have to pay a large financial penalty in a time we don't have a lot of money on the state. So something to be worried about. Other questions we get about this, sort of counter-arguments that you might hear is, you know, the state enters into kinds of contracts all the time. How is this different than other types of contracts? And maybe the two most prominent ones are the teacher pensions that Helen mentioned earlier, and the CBAC agreement with state employees that happened in 2017. We do think this is different for several reasons. So with comparisons to the teacher pensions, you know, basically it was this 2008 deal. We're going to sell bonds, we're going to promise to bondholders that we're not going to change, or that we're going to contribute the actuarial amount to the teacher retirement fund for the next 30 years. It only covers pensions, not all funds. When you think of the bond lock, through the spending gap, it actually covers the entire general fund. A bond for school construction would cover spending on Medicaid, for example. You know, completely, extremely wide-ranging, very, very scary. We should also note that, you know, given this sort of disagreement about to what extent it can be financed or spread out these payments, just shows how seriously the Treasurer and the state takes these bond covenants. So it's not something that's willing to break very easily. The second sort of big contractual agreement that people talk about is the CBAC agreement. So last year, policymakers and the state employee union came together to create a new agreement, a labor contract. Now this is a collective bargaining issue. It's not a bonding issue. It's also only covers, again, it's narrow, it covers employee compensation, it doesn't cover the entire budget. This thing has been renegotiated in the past and could potentially be renegotiated in the future, whereas renegotiating with bondholders could be a lot more difficult. So that said, so what are we proposing? Or, you know, this thing is really bad, how do we break it, I guess, is the more.
Breaking bad.
Yes, breaking the bad bond line. All right, so our number one priority in this legislative session is getting rid of this thing, getting rid of the bond lock, repealing it outright. And just to emphasize, because this goes into effect in May, we have to do this session, and, you know, sooner rather than later. Because after May 15th, that first bond is issued, we're locked in for the next decade.
So some people have said, well, why don't we just see how it goes? Bad as you say, we'll repeal it later. But even if we repeal it, if it's written into a bond that's issued in the interim, it's in effect. Even if it's just one bond that's been issued, that one bond that has the bond lock in it is going to be in effect for the 10-year life of the bond.
Absolutely. And, you know, we came to that at least delay the study to make sure that, you know, legislators and policymakers fully understand the implications of what's going on. There's also all sorts of other policy proposals that have to do with the individual caps and restrictions themselves. To be honest, I think maybe these may be a little less critical this session is because we can change those after the bond lock has been repealed or delayed. And that's really sort of the policy aspect.